This is not a game. This is a 12-week job interview. Never, ever, ever underestimate me.
14 people came to London in search of a job.
I don't like liars. I don't like cheats. I don't like bullshitters. I don't like schmoozers. I don't like arse-lickers.
They've come to battle it out for a job with Sir Alan Sugar.
I would have told you to piss off.
Tough and uncompromising, Sir Alan is at the top of his game with a global empire worth £700 million. He's offering one job with a six-figure salary.
I'm gonna fucking win this night if it kills me.
To get it, they'll have to work and live together and face a weekly business task.
You can't fucking fire me!
Do you feel the pressure is building?
This is the ultimate job interview.
You're fired. You're fired. You're fired.
Last week on The Apprentice, James and Syra had the last laugh. Faced with the challenge of selling on TV...
We're going to move on to the next item, because this is the wolf jacket.
It's too warm, dry and...
Syra was keen to show she was more than just a saleswoman. James was the presenter, but Syra still had a lot to say.
Well done. Now play with your toy. Show them the big face at the front.
It's got a wonderful, wonderful big face at the front.
On the other team...
I've got some amazing products for a...
Project manager Miriam was such a natural...
We're already selling, Mim. We're already selling.
...that Tim and Paul felt confident enough to limit their comments to compliments.
Brilliant smile.
Start off by...
Miriam looked the part on screen, but her team still lost. In the boardroom, Sir Alan asked Miriam who deserved to be let off the hook.
Probably Tim.
Paul, you are a renegade. I'm sorry, Paul. I'm very sorry. I do like you as a person. I'm sorry to have to say these things to you. But I'm even more sorry when I've got to tell you, Miriam, you're fired.
Miriam became the 10th casualty of the boardroom.
You know I've made mistakes in the past, and maybe I've made a mistake here, but we'll see.
What the hell happened there? But when he came straight to me,
and he said,
I thought, that's it. You know, I started straightening my tie. I see a lot of you and me, but Paul, it breaks my heart, blah, 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 blah. I thought, start the engine. Mim, you're fired.
Now only four remain to fight for the chance to become the apprentice.
It's getting a bit scared. I feel a bit scared about things now because it's like the last four and it's all getting a bit too pressured.
I agree.
At the house, Syra and James have no idea who will be returning.
If I was Sir Alan and I was looking for the final four, I would have got rid of Paul.
Sir Alan has had plenty of opportunity to fire Paul before, and he hasn't.
He hasn't.
And he saved him. I just, every time he goes into that boardroom, he fights so hard.
Sir Alan only sees what he sees in the boardroom. So in terms of trustworthiness, respect, telling the truth, all that, Sir Alan doesn't see all of that.
I know.
And Paul is just defies every single one of those things.
This is a story I want to hear. Well done, final four. Well done, mate.
How tall are you?
Well done.
I'm glad to be here, mate.
Well done. Was it between you and Miriam?
No.
He said to Miriam, if I let one of you three swim away, Miriam, who shall I let swim away?
Hypothetically.
Yeah, and she said, Tim. So he said to me, Paul, does that surprise you? I said, no, it doesn't surprise me. He said, why? I said, because Miriam doesn't really like me, but she likes Tim.
So,
and then Sarah went back to her and said, you think Paul is an arrogant git? And she went, not give.
Not give, but yeah.
He said three. And Paul said, went back and said, well, it's just, the fact is, when I'm good at something, I'll tell everybody I'm good at it. And I'm not afraid to say I'm good at it. She doesn't like that.
Hello, Sarah speaking.
Hello, Francis here from Sir Alan's office.
Hello, Francis.
Hello. Can you please be ready to leave the house tomorrow morning at 6:45 a.m?
Yep.
You need to have your suitcases packed.
Suitcases packed. Guys, we've just got a phone call. Boys.
Yeah?
We've got a phone call.
What happened?
Francis.
Yeah?
Where's Paul?
He's coming. He's in the garden.
6:45. We're leaving tomorrow morning. And all she said is have your suitcases packed. We're leaving the house.
Oh,
I'm gonna better start packing.
Better start packing.
This week, the candidates face a very different challenge. They've been called to Sir Alan's business HQ for a briefing.
You may be wondering what we're going to get up to today, and may also be wondering about some of these new faces that you see here. And what's going to happen is that you lot are going to go through a grueling interview. And at the end of the interview session, they're going to sit down with me and they're going to give me their opinion about whether any of you here are worthy of working for me. Nick and Margaret are very well known to you. Now, Claude, he's actually been in Denmark for me, he's been in Paris. He's actually ran Tottenham Hotspur for quite a while, that's why he's lost a bit of hair. Borden has been in Australia, he's been in Italy, and currently runs our computer organisation at Vigeland. Paul doesn't actually work for me, but he's associated with me. Okay, he's a very successful businessman in his own right, and he's here to give me a view from a younger perspective. This whole process has never ever been a joke, as far as I'm concerned, okay? And I don't want any of you to think that I personally are going to be persuaded by what television companies and production companies want to see and want to hear in choosing the person that's going to come and work for me, okay? Get that right in your heads. Get it right in your heads, because I mean it, because seriously, there's a job here for somebody, okay? And if you might have thought throughout the course of this exercise that it's been a bit of a game, well, I can understand you having those feelings. But look at me, look at my eyes. I'm telling you, I don't give a monkey's about what they think. I don't listen to what they tell me, and I don't listen to what any television company tells me what to do. I'm looking for somebody to work for me, all right? Serious, dead serious. Got it?
Got it.
Okay. Well, you know, at the end of this process, any one of you is going to be fired.
Over the next few hours, each candidate will be interviewed by Sir Alan's three new advisors and by his trusted aides, Nick and Margaret. The interviewers will grill the candidates on both their professional and personal lives.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello, Paul.
Oh, not too bad.
Good to meet you.
You too.
Thank you.
Who do you think is going to win?
Me. I've got a problem with you.
Okay.
I mean, yes, I'm Italian. I do have a temper, definitely.
That's not an excuse for having a temper.
I don't think it's any mistake that out of the 10 tasks that we've done to date, I've been on the winning team 8 times.
You're not really interested in money, or you are interested in money?
I am interested in money, but it's not the main thing.
Are you here for the money?
Money's a part of it.
There isn't any bullshit factor.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, you're a self-confessed liar, aren't you?
Not really. Not really.
You're deceived in your CV. I mean, it says it quite clearly here. Yes, I lied on my CV. I changed the dates so that it looked like I was in a role for 12 months when in fact I was in a position for 6 months.
People look at things and they make a judgment on, you know, what it says on your CV. Mm. Now, I know I'm capable of doing most things that I put my mind to. And in order to get a foot through the door, I had to make sure that I wasn't kind of discriminated against in any way. And I know I'm not the only person that does that.
So you're prepared to lie to get on in life?
I'm not prepared to lie. I'm prepared to bend the rules within reason. That's what I'm prepared to do.
Right.
At the end of the day, I want to work for Sir Alan Sugar, and why I want this job is because I respect Sir Alan, I like his values, I like the fact that he's straight-talking, and
do
I
you think you're straight-talking?
Absolutely.
You do?
Absolutely.
You don't think you just tell people what they want to hear?
I'm a saleswoman, and let's be very clear.
I know
clear.
That, I can see from
I'm a saleswoman, and if I can read body language, I have to think what other people want to hear sometimes. But
so what's my body language telling you?
I think your body language is saying she's got to convince me a bit more. I'm not that convinced by her at the moment.
No, you're right, I'm not convinced by you.
On a scale of 10, where would you grade yourself?
Sales and marketing, I would say 9.5.
So you're that good?
I'm that good, but there's room for improvement.
Right.
What I've demonstrated so far is that any situation that you want to put me in, mm-hmm. I think I could probably cope, survive and thrive.
Right.
However, I think there are things which I'm very good at.
Mm-hmm.
Finalist of the Young Property Personality of the Year 2004.
Yes.
Well, that's fairly recent.
Yes.
So you have got a flair for property.
Yes. But I don't think it's as challenging or as exciting as what's
as being
potentially
on television.
I didn't pick this because I wanted to be on telly.
Right.
If I wanted to just be on telly, there are other things I can go and do. I've got an actor brother and a cellist brother.
Have you?
And, you know, I think all the people who started on this, none of them were aspiring wannabes.
I want this job. I'm not here for TV. I said to people before when they asked me in interviews, would you do this without TV? 100%, yes, because this is a unique opportunity.
Mm.
I want it, basically.
Right, and what's unique about you, then?
Unique about me is that my personality is effervescent. It's magnetism, do you see what I mean? I can work with anybody from shop floor to boardroom, on the street, in an office, whatever it needs, and I can mix with everybody because where I've come from.
So you consider yourself a bit of a chameleon?
No.
You're able to change
definitely.
Adapt to situations?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah? Now, you because you've had a fairly limited path in terms of career successes and achievements,
yep.
You've managed to describe what essentially is a somebody works in the ticket office at a train station.
Yep.
As a lot more than that. Do you think you're trying it on today?
I'm trying to impress you. I'm trying to impress everybody that I've seen.
Mm. Do you think you've got a nerve to come for this job?
Of course I have. I have every right to come for this job. There was like 6,000 people I applied, I got through, and it wasn't by accident. And I've got through to the last four, not by accident either.
How do you feel about being in the last four?
Excited, nervous, eager for the challenge.
Do you keep your cool?
Yeah, there's times when I lose my temper. Definitely.
Well, I mean, there's a particular time I'm talking about in your background resume where you really lost your temper, isn't it?
Is there?
I don't know, you tell me.
I thought you just said that there was a time.
Yeah, well, there is a time, isn't it? In your background.
Being drunk and disorderly, I mean, is drinking a big part of your life or not really? I mean, do you
Paul,
drink when
got,
you're under pressure?
You've got that completely incorrect.
Right.
I wasn't drunk and disorderly.
Right, what were you then?
I've had my collar felt twice. Firstly, I had some property in
North
So
you
weren't
Lincoln. Convicted of being disorderly?
It was a section...
Disorderly behaviour?
It was a Section B public order offence.
Right.
Nothing to do with drinking.
Right, it was nothing. So you were disorderly without drink?
Yeah.
I'm really happy that I've got this far, but I do believe that I am one of the two...
The chosen?
One of the chosen few, yes.
OK.
Do you get on well with the other candidates?
I do. I haven't had a single argument or altercation with them.
Do they know that you think you're the best?
They know that I think highly of myself, yeah.
No, you think you're the best. You think you're the winner.
I do think that I am the one that will get the job.
You do?
Definitely.
Thank you very much. Nice to meet you.
Finally, after four long hours...
Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's all over. And the candidates have a moment to gather their thoughts.
This was the best task to do because you don't have to rely on anybody else.
No, this
it's
is
only
down
yourself.
To you.
It's down to you.
If I go, I couldn't have done any better in those interviews.
I
just gave it my best, you know, my best shout.
I agree. UP?
I found it all quite boring.
Really?
Yeah.
Why?
Because it just was.
Why?
All four were exactly the same. They didn't take a different approach with me, I found. They picked the CVs, you know, you've done this and you've done that. And I thought to myself, you can go in there with a script and come out of there with 8 out of 10 from each interview. And they didn't really dig into me. They tried to, but, you know, they didn't. And at 34, I've been in situations 20 times harder than that in my life. I'm going to look a right wally now if I get fired. But by the same token, I couldn't have performed any better. Yeah. It was just, to me, it was just a bit run-of-the-mill.
The candidates must wait outside the boardroom while Sir Alan consults the consultants. They'll give their judgment on each would-be apprentice, starting with 34-year-old James Max.
People may have a stereotypical view of what I might be like, either from how I talk or how I present myself to indeed, you know, some of the smiles and the flippancy. And they may not necessarily want to or take the time to get to know the real James.
The real James has been on the winning team in 8 out of 10 tasks. That makes him the most successful candidate. He's also the only one to have been paid a six-figure salary as an investment banker.
Well, Alan, I'm not that positive about James. I don't even know what he was doing here this morning. I mean, to me, he's not an apprentice, yeah? He's a graduate surveyor. I've seen hundreds of them, I'm sure you have. I didn't see any raw talent in him. I think he's bright. But I think if you put an advert in the Standard, you'd see plenty of those guys. I also don't actually think that he's here for the right reasons. That was the feeling I got.
What do you mean by that?
I think he's here for the cameras, Alan. I don't think he's looking at this job. I think he had an air of aloofness around him, as if he was better than what you were looking for, and I don't think he is.
Just switching completely to the other end, to Nick and Margaret, same guy, James.
He's a very presentable guy. I asked him how long it would take to get from Knightsbridge to Brentwood in his Aston Martin, and he wasn't altogether sure.
One of the things on his resume was that when he'd been asked what he didn't like, and one of the things was this group of initials, HKLP, and I thought, well, I don't know what that means, but then nobody knew what it meant, so we asked him.
This is very rude, but nevertheless, HKLP is actually holds knife like pen. And I was always taught to hold my cutlery in a certain way, and it just brings me out in bristles when people don't.
So, I mean, you know,
overall,
what message am I getting from you two, really?
Because overall,
I
mean, if you had it in mind to really grow your property business in a big way, and you wanted somebody to go out looking for acquisitions, of the four, he's the only one that could do it.
Borden?
I absolutely concur with what you're saying. It struck me he wasn't here to win. There's something else that's in his agenda. You know, financially, he's obviously earning a lot more than this position.
Yeah, that's an interesting one. Did anybody broach that?
Yeah, he said he wanted to learn something new, didn't he? Yeah. He didn't want to do another property fund, which is what the last thing
he's done. I'm not sure he totally understood where you're at and what you're doing and how he could contribute to that. I think in terms of, does he want to be an apprentice? Does he want to get stuck in? Does he want to deliver something? I'm not sure.
OK. Let's talk about Sarah.
Over the past 10 weeks, 34-year-old saleswoman Sarah Khan has enjoyed spectacular success and dismal failure.
I think I'm a strong person and I'm equal to any man out there, and I've shown stamina and strength, stand up for myself, and I'm proud, and I hope all the women out there are going to root for me and, you know, kind of say, well, yeah, well done, Sarah, you know, good for you for representing us.
Let's start off with Margaret and Nick here again. Margaret, perhaps?
Yeah, I mean, she's first and foremost a salesperson that's come through. She's had a lot of different jobs. She's moved around a lot.
She's loud, she's aggressive and forceful, and sometimes people just don't much care for that sort of thing.
Mm. You refer to yourself as being somebody who is impulsive, impatient, unreasonable, stubborn, confrontational. Mm-hmm. Now, to an employer, that is red rag.
I don't think they're negative skills. People can look at those and say, well, you know, blimey, I can't handle that. Put me in a business situation, those skills then become actually quite important.
When we started off, I looked at her resume and I thought, I'm not going to like this person. Too aggressive, too combative. But as I got to speak to her and discuss things with her, I could see that she is a forceful salesperson. So if you've got a sales role in mind for her, I think she'd be a fine choice for you. Anything else, she's unproven.
Unproven?
Her comfort zone is sales.
Paul?
I saw the saleswoman in her, and she wasn't selling to me. I liked her, but I just think there's a lack of substance there. She's just a good sales lady, and I don't know if that constitutes what I would call a good apprentice.
Let's go to the youngest candidate, Tim.
27-year-old Tim Campbell has only ever worked for London Underground. A graduate trainee, he's fought his way up to middle management.
I'm completely excited. I'm so excited about being in the Final Four. It's unbelievable. It was always a goal to make sure I got to this stage and then be ready to go into the final stage. But when you're actually going through the task, you meet the people who you're thinking, you think, bloody hell, there's a lot of clever people around here. Not to say that I'm any stupid idiot, but the fact is, these people have got a lot more experience than I ever had.
So why are you so driven? What is it in your character and makeup that makes you want to achieve more?
I think it comes from my mother. Basically, she brought three kids up by herself, and she never complained working three jobs with three kids and making sure that she gave everything that was necessary to us. To turn around now and be a lazy bum would be disrespectful to my mother.
He's 27, so a 27-year-old man, you can't expect a lifetime of experience. I think, though, that his experience is very limited. I'm just concerned about how you're going to be able to get anything worthwhile out of him.
Paul?
If our job was to unearth a gem today, I think Tim's the gem.
When the lights go down,
yep,
and everybody's stopped watching you,
yep,
are you going to cope, or are you just good in front of the cameras?
The fact is, the cameras haven't been on me 24 hours a day, and the fact is I've worked 100% of the time throughout those 24 hours a day. You ask anybody I've worked in any single team and they'll tell you Tim doesn't stop. If Tim's on a task, Tim doesn't go toilet, Tim doesn't eat, Tim doesn't smoke, Tim just goes full on.
And how tough have you found today in relation to the rest of the tasks that you've undertaken?
Today's been the easiest for me.
It's been the easiest, isn't it?
The easiest for me for the simple reason it's me against somebody else. I don't have to worry about it.
You think you're against me, do you?
To a degree, yes, there is a kind of a battle in terms of, not an antagonistic battle, but there's a challenge there in terms of you need to get something from me and I have to give you something. And if they don't match, then that's it, curtains.
Right.
In my business, I have to go and find deals, yeah? He would be my deal.
Really? OK, Paul.
34-year-old Paul Teresi has never been afraid to speak his mind.
I can sell anything.
Well, you didn't.
No, I resent that.
He's ended up in the firing line four times.
Why shouldn't I fire you, Paul?
I haven't done anything wrong. Why should you fire me?
But his confrontational style has won him favour with Sir Alan.
If I were Sir Alan, I would employ me.
But Claude?
Well, my view is that you've got a complex character. Very aggressive, unnecessarily fiery, and I think that clearly you'd have trouble with him, he'd have trouble with you. It's not a marriage made in heaven, this one.
Frankly, I'm surprised he's made the semi-finals. I've got serious issues with this young man. He came into the interview very, very aggressive.
I own some property in Newcastle, some offices, shops, that kind of thing.
What value?
Three and a half million pounds
worth of property you've got?
Yeah.
And what sort of mortgages have you got on that?
I have mortgages on them.
You've got mortgages on? What level of mortgages? I'm trying to establish, Paul, what you've achieved before you came for this job.
Right.
And whether or not you in fact need this job.
Yeah.
You've got three and a half million pounds worth of property in Newcastle.
Yeah.
Surely it's a perfectly reasonable question for me to ask.
Yeah.
If you've been successful in property.
Yeah.
What are the fruits of that success? What do you own? So you've said you've got some office buildings and some residential units, particularly in Newcastle.
Yeah. I've got some property in London as well.
And you've got some property in London.
And the Caribbean.
I mean, you sound a bit of a... And the Caribbean.
And in France as well.
Wow. I mean, you sound quite successful, Paul.
I've not done bad, but I don't want to
sound... I
mean,
the reason I say that is I happen to be in the property business too.
Right.
Yeah, and I wouldn't be sitting here looking for a job with Alan Sugar.
yeah, because I've got an existing successful business.
Right.
You strike me that you have two, yeah? Unless, of course, you've got carried away and we've gone down an avenue perhaps you didn't plan on going down, and you may have exaggerated things a little.
No, I don't know. What I've said is utterly the truth. The fact that I'm not prepared to discuss finance should lead you to think that I'm not here for the cameras, but I'm here, you know,
It doesn't lead me to believe that at all, as it happens, but it doesn't matter. You've said in your...
Towards the end of the interview, I started to like him a bit more, but I think that with him, I just got the impression that he felt, you know, he'd achieved everything, and actually, if you were lucky, he might consider joining you. That's the impression I got.
I see.
I think that the fact that he's looking for someone shows that there is something that he's not happy with within his organisation.
Why do you think that?
Because he's going down this road. He's taking time out himself. I can imagine just how busy he is.
I'd be quite intrigued to see that he's going to take someone off the street on an apprentice and actually start taking instructions or their view.
I don't think he's too big for that. I think he's magnanimous enough to realise that if there's something wrong... Mm. And you see, I'm guilty of the same thing. When someone has their own company, it's their little baby. But it shows a lot about his character that he could stand back and say, right, I need someone to be able to look in here and say, right, what's the problem here? Why aren't we turning over gold?
So I'm a bit confused then, because I thought the name of the programme was The Apprentice.
Right.
I thought you were coming to learn.
Yes, but in that case, why doesn't he get some spotty-faced teenager at 17 years old rather than someone that's 34 years old or 36 or 39 or 40.
You tell me, it's called The Apprentice, that's what you've come here for.
Yes, we've come here to be apprentices to Sir Alan,
mm-hmm.
but by the same token, I think he wants someone with some experience.
I think he got confused. I don't think he knows that he's here to be an apprentice. I think he's here, in fact, to be your troubleshooter to help put all your wrongs and ills to right.
Troublemaker, maybe.
Well, maybe, but certainly the thing was he was here to fix the group's issues.
A fixer. He thinks we've got problems.
Yeah, absolutely. I think he got confused between...
You think I need him, is that what you're saying?
Is that the impression you got,
that I
absolutely.
Need him?
Yeah. Can I just say one thing in Paul's defence, yeah?
I think he's taken a terrible
hammering this afternoon. When you fight fire with fire with Paul, when it's clear that you're not going to listen to his crap, yeah, and you tell him to calm down, or he learns that he needs to calm down, then he becomes far more personable and better to talk to.
Actually, I'd like to add something in his favour as well. I mean, if you were prepared to put the time in with him, I think he's got the attributes that could be tamed, but it would need your time.
It looks to me that it doesn't matter who I pick here, there's going to need to be a lot of investment.
Alan, if you're going to spend time with someone, there's no point in spending time with someone like A, Paul, who thinks he knows it all, and James, who's probably too long in the tooth to be taught. You know,
He's 34.
He's a graduate, he's been taught in a certain way, and if Alan's going to spend time with him, Alan's going to teach them his way. You've got to start with the raw product,
I agree.
And the raw product is not James.
I don't agree.
James is a graduate surveyor who, if it wasn't The Apprentice, he would apply for Blind Date or any other show, yeah? That's what I saw in James.
Margaret and Nick.
Who?
Let me tell you, I'm discounting Paul.
If I can just kick off,
it's up to you. That's
Sarah, I think you could put into a sales situation and not actually need to spend too much time with, because I think it would be a waste of your time, because that's where she's good, and you know, just popping.
Well, the point is, sales enough? I mean, you know, the thing is sales enough? But you see, the importance of people like Borden is a good salesman, but he's also a seller and a buyer.
I think she's a buyer as well. I think she's very good at negotiating, so I think she'd negotiate well buying as she would selling.
Claude?
You can't ask for something of somebody who hasn't got it. So Tim can be a very, very quick learner, but I...
You don't think he's got it?
You haven't given him a chance to get it, Claude, have you?
That's fine. Look, it's just a perception. I saw the guy for half an hour. One has to make judgments. My judgment from seeing him for half an hour, and I haven't had the benefit of Margaret and Nick's opportunity of seeing them actually doing tasks, is that he's an extremely nice, likeable fellow who's done very, very well. I'm not sure how much further he's going to go, even with, you know, the input that you might be able to give him. And if you were going to spend some time with somebody, it depends on the job, but I would have thought that James is the kind of person who is intellectually more able than the others, and even though you know, you sort of think that he's got ulterior motives for being here, the fact is that if he is here, he's going to be expected to do a job. And I'm concerned that Tim, if we're just sort of talking about him for a moment, might struggle. He's a risk.
You've got to remember what the role is here. It's an apprentice role here. You know, you've got to find out whether the guy's up for it, whether he's got the grade.
OK. Well, look, guys, this has been great. I've got to tell you, it's been much better than I thought. It's been very useful to take your brains, because you know me, and I think I've got a clear direction, OK?
After 2 hours, the waiting is over. Having successfully completed 10 weeks of The Apprentice, the candidates are used to entering the boardroom knowing that one of them will be fired. But this time, they've been told that two will be going home.
James, why on earth do you want to take a pay cut? I can't get my brain around it, and neither could some of my colleagues.
Mm-hmm. What this opportunity is to me is a chance to work with you and with your team, who are very experienced and have a very wide array of business activities.
But, James, come on, look. We're not...
I see it as a platform.
We're not Glaxo. I mean, this is Alan Sugar and his organisation, okay.
But you're very entrepreneurial in what you do and what your company does. And I see it as a springboard and a challenge, which I can't get within a big, you know, lovely, cuddly organisation. And what I would like is somebody who says, right, okay, you think you're good enough, prove it. And I think you would do that. Because I don't think you want
to. Is it a game?
No.
In a game, prove it, and so you prove it to me.
No,
and then you piss off a year later because you've proven it.
It's not a game, and it's not a game to give up your job. And I'm not taking this as a joke. I'm not taking it as something that I just want to arrive in your office, swan about for a bit, and then bugger off. Because in all my jobs to date, I would say that I've shown commitment, and I would like to take it further. And I want to find a position that allows me to develop my career.
Paul, similar question to you. You have told my interviewers that, you know, you've got a good business. You ran your dad's business. You know, it seemed to me that you're quite well-to-do at the moment, set up, well-to-do. What do you want to come and work for me for?
I want to work for you because I always thought that I was a capable chap. And the problem that I've had sometimes is that I've had to work for myself because I wasn't given opportunity to work for big companies. And I always thought that I had a lot to give a big company.
But Paul, excuse me, you took the giant leap of working for yourself. To me, that was a fantastic thing when I did that myself, right? It was a brave move. And I'll tell you what, wild horses would have dragged me back to working for someone else again.
Ultimately, the companies that I have are property-based companies, and they can run themselves. So the way I see it is that working for you, I can put to effect the experience that I've learned, but also, I'm not going to go downhill, I'm going to go uphill, because I'm taking on an extra salary and everything else is still coming in as before.
What are you going to be doing if someone's phoning you up telling you about got a leaking roof somewhere? Where's your attention going to be? With me or with your business?
Sir Alan, I wouldn't waste anybody's time by being here. I've sacrificed a lot to be here. I have a pregnant wife at home, I have a 9-year-old boy, and I have businesses.
Don't cut with me all that crap. Don't give me all that personal crap here, right? Because there's also another reason why some people will be here. Some people might want to come here for the same reason as they go on Big Brother, right? They want personal fame. I'm looking for somebody who wants a job. I'm asking you the question, Why do you want to work for me? And if you've got a good business yourself, why don't you stick to working for yourself?
If I don't get this job, I will. But working for you, working for a large organisation, is something that I've always wanted to do, but I was never in the position to do it. That's why I've had to be self-employed.
Tim. Tim, the general theme from my advisors and my colleagues that came through their discussions with you was that you lack real commercial experience. Would you go along with that?
Totally. Well, there's nothing I can say. My CV talks volumes in terms of compared to other individuals who have been here from the very beginning.
Yeah.
My lack of commercial experience is an issue, and I've identified that as myself. But as I've said, in terms of wanting somebody who has a desire to do the job and can do the job, I think I have those skills within me. I can do that. All I need is direction from somebody to put me in the right direction to say, do this, this is how you do it, get on with it. And I don't have a problem with doing that.
But, young. Sarah, are you going to piss off everybody that works for me?
No.
You sure?
Yeah.
Because you did not do a good job here with some people, you know.
I don't think I've pissed anybody off, Sir Alan. Who have I pissed off?
Well, my worry is that I don't sell flowers in the street.
Right.
And, you know, I don't stand shouting with megaphones. What I do is I have to deal every day of my life with the buyers of the major chain stores. Shouting at them is going to get you nowhere. Well, it will get you somewhere. It will get you through the bloody door. That's where it will get you, and you'll never, ever be able to walk in there again. OK? Is that going to happen with you?
While I can sell and tackle people to the ground to buy flowers, I've also stood in a boardroom environment with the toys and presented professionally to a corporate group of people. And I think the feedback you would have got from them would have been very good.
Because I'm looking for more than salesperson, as you would appreciate.
I think salespeople come with a lot more, Sir Alan.
What I want you to tell me about is anything apart from selling. Tell me about where you demonstrated to me that you're not just a one show-in-town person,
okay.
Sales only.
The farm task that we had to do, the chutney idea, I think I demonstrated a lot of commercial awareness and a good brain for business, because we won that task by a lot of money, and I was a key pinpoint in that.
A difficult decision, a very, very difficult decision. Sarah, have you got the skills, all-round skills? James has got the all-round skills, but I'm worried about whether he wants to come to Brentwood Towers.
Just to clarify, I'm happy coming to Brentwood Towers. I understand that.
Tim, I've read your resume. An East End boy. Hard upbringing. Your mum.
She did well.
Well, she must be very proud of you.
She is.
As another East End boy, I'm also very proud of you to see what you've done.
Thank you.
In difficult circumstances. I'm struggling as to whether... And I've got to know me now as a person, whether I've got the time or the wherewithal and the patience. That's what I'm struggling with. It's a very, very tough thing, you know, for me to say. I'm going to let you stay. James, you haven't convinced me. I don't think you're going to be a long-term player for me, to be perfectly honest. That's my only reason. I think you've been excellent, very professional. I'm letting you go. You're fired. We'll be right back.
Sure.
Thanks.
Paul, I'm an obstinate person, but even I've learned that when 10 people are saying something to you and you still want to do something else, then even me, I've got to turn around and say, all right, I've got to go with what the other people are saying. And without a question of a doubt, every single one of my advisors, including these two that sit here, find you aggressive. They find you a person that's not going to mould with other people. And some of them believe that you have an air about you that actually you're not coming here to learn, you know it all. You're coming here really to help out problems that I'm in, to be a troubleshooter and all that type of stuff. Well, let me tell you, I ain't got any problems that need troubleshooting, certainly not by a 34-year-old gentleman like you. What you got to say about that unanimous statement about you, Paul? Because, you know, the other day, I backed you, you know? I said I see a lot of me in you. I see a lot of me in you when I was your age. But I'm getting this kind of message from everybody. He's aggressive. What you got to say about that?
I am 34 years old. I haven't just done one thing in life. I've done lots of things in life. I've been in sales. I've dealt with manufacturing. And in manufacturing and production, you learn an awful lot. I think possibly the way it's come across is that I have nothing more to learn, which is ridiculous, because you learn every day of your life. But the fact is that I was coming here to show you that I wasn't just one bag of tricks. I had a lot to offer. And so consequently, the fact that you're looking for an apprentice, you're looking for somebody, A, to learn, but B, I'm not a spotty 17-year-old. You know, you surely must be looking for someone with some experience so that rather than you spending 8 hours a day with that person, moulding them into exactly what you want, you'll think to yourself, this guy already has some standing, but he needs to learn some more, which is why I'm here.
Have you got some standing?
Well, I have some experience in the things that I've
listed. If you had standing in the businesses that you've started of your own, I go back to, what the hell do you want to come and work for me for? Because I'll tell you, when I started my business at the age of 18, I would have never, ever gone back to work for anybody else in my life.
But we're different.
Well, if we're different then, Paul, maybe you've just answered it for me, because I can't afford to gamble on you, Paul. As experienced as I am, I've got to listen to what other people are saying to me. And there's too many vibes coming through that says to me, Paul, I'm gonna have to let you go. You're fired.
Do you know, before I came here, I didn't know a single person that had a bad word to say about me. And I've taken nothing but criticism in the whole time that I've been here. Why is that? That I don't know anyone with a bad word to say about me, yet here I haven't got a single person to say a good word about me, apart from the people that I lived in the house with.
Why is that? Good question. Well, go away and think about it.
Well, I've got nothing better to do now, have I?
You're responsible for those last two going. I put my trust in you too, because it's not been an easy task, I tell you, okay? You've got a lot on your shoulders now, you two. A lot resting on your shoulders. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna give you a call, as usual. We'll meet soon, and I'll let you know what the final task is gonna be.
Thank you.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh my God.
You ready?
I'm just like.
I know. Come, let's go. Come.
Oh. Oh my God. I just can't stop smiling.
I gave it my best shot. In a sense, I think it's slightly disappointing that people didn't break through perhaps their perception of me and my aspirations. Maybe he just thought I wasn't right personality-wise for him or his team, and I respect that.
Yes, sometimes I am tough in my approach, but I definitely don't see it as being aggressive. And a good salesman, a good entrepreneur and a good businessman has to be aggressive. Sir Alan never made a £700 million fortune by being soft. And when he said to me in one or two boardrooms that there are elements within me that he saw many years ago in himself, so consequently I thought, well, that's going to stand me in good stead because that shows him that I am built of the same kind of stuff. But obviously, that didn't count for shit, really, because, you know, he fired me.
One job, now just two candidates. Sir Alan's search for his apprentice is almost over. Next week on The Apprentice, look who's back.
The thing is, I'm quite happy to fire you, Paul, if you are going to take this kind of...
Oh, fuck off. Talk. You can't fucking fire me.
I can't.
Everyone takes to the boats for the grand finale. It's sink or swim, as Tim goes head-to-head with Siren.
I knew we were fucking around.
The skipper comes aboard.
Get me a drink at least, man. Come on, hurry up.
But the crew is all at sea.
Oh, shit.
And when the party's over, someone is going to get hired.